Vice Chancellor. In recognition of his major contribution both to science and to society, I invite you to confer on Professor Noam Chomsky the degree of Doctor of Letters, Honoris Causa.
Te ad gradum doctores literarum honoris causa promovio, cuius rei in symbolum, super te hoc veretum impono.
Well, I'm a little reluctant to draw any conclusion. I mean, I have a kind of an instinctive favor, feeling in favor of devolution, regionalization, turning to local authorities and so on. On the other hand, there are costs. And I don't think you can take a casual attitude towards estimating the costs and the benefits without really thinking through what the people on the scene are, what it's going to mean to them. Yeah. And without an intimate acquaintance with the particular circumstances, I think it's kind of irresponsible to draw judgments. My own feeling would be in favor of devolution, but there's so many consequences that have to be worked out that I think it just has to be evaluated by the people who are going to live with the consequences. Instinctive feeling is the more devolution, the better. But on the other hand, there are consequences to be thought through. And without, again, I think it's just irresponsible to draw conclusions without working through the consequences. Queen of the Diamond Jubilee. Well. I think I told you this story already, but I have an Australian friend, a kind of a radical philosopher in Australia, who in Australia a couple of years ago they had a referendum on whether to become a republic or to stay within the empire. And of course all of his friends and associates were in favor of becoming a republic, throwing off the trappings of empire. And he surprised them all by writing a letter in the major journal saying he was in favor of staying in the empire. And then a lot of critical letters came in and he answered back and he said, well, he's in favor of it because the empire is so ludicrous. It's just all of its trappings just lead to disrespect for authority in the state, which he thought is a good thing, you know. So. It's okay if people enjoy it. Actually, my wife and I happened to be here when, in London, when Queen Elizabeth was at the coronation. We were students knocking around Europe, backpacking, and it was kind of fun, you know, as long as you didn't take it seriously. As little as I can manage. I mean, you can't get along without faith in something or other. You can't evaluate, work out the details of whether the next time you take a step, you're going to fall into a pit, let's say. So you have certain faith in uniformity of nature and the way people are going to behave and so on. But by and large, when something significant comes along, having irrational beliefs, I think, is generally not a good idea. And if that's what faith means, I think it's not a good idea. So, of course, we all live by faith and this, that, and the other thing, because we can't, you know, we can't work out the consequences of every tiny action we carry out, and we have assumptions about the world and what it's like and so on. But beyond that, faith that interferes with thinking problems through is dubious. Same in the sciences. I mean, any work you do in the most technical area, the sciences, is guided by beliefs that you don't question. On the other hand, they should be open to question. Like, they shouldn't be sacrosanct. So if some reason comes along to question them, you ought to be open to questioning them, even your most fundamental premises and principles. It has effect on the behavior, but it doesn't affect language. It just as language was the actual language that people's language, we have a kind of a language faculty. It's an aspect of our cognitive system. It's genetically based. And that hasn't changed for at least 50,000 years, no matter with all the changes in culture and variation and kinds of society and so on. It's, we have exactly the same language instinct as primitive tribes in Amazonia that have never had, haven't had other human contact for 20,000 years. And you can tell that very easily. I mean, if an infant from one of those tribes is brought here to St. Andrews as an infant, it'll learn to speak like every kid in the streets, and conversely, which means that the language capacity is the same. It hasn't changed. The language use changes all the time. And texting may have some effect on, probably quite peripheral on language use. It may not be entirely peripheral. So for example, there are studies of Middle English and later English syntactic structure, and it turns out that embedded relative clauses, you know, a relative clause inside a longer sentence, tends not to be used much in writing in earlier English and is used constantly later. It's assumed that that's probably the effect of literacy. Effective literacy is to get you to use more of your language capacity than you otherwise might. But the capacity doesn't change. Students who are graduating from a place like this are pretty privileged people. That means they have lots of opportunities, more than almost anyone in the world or in past history. And the only reasonable advice you can give to anyone is think through your opportunities, think through what goals you want to achieve, and figure out ways to advance towards those goals, whether they're in personal life or in the way you act in the world as a decent human being and so on. A lot of options. Mm-hmm. And a lot of options means a lot of responsibility. So think it through. I can't give it. I'd never tried to give advice to my own children. You know, if I had, they wouldn't listen. Things that you wouldn't even know about. There are poor communities around the world. In the United States, Colombia, southeastern Turkey, refugee camps for whom I've been able to do things, and they're grateful for it, and I think that's an achievement. Deeply indoctrinated Western religious belief that pictures a debate like this. It says there are two sides, Israel and the Palestinians. The United States is an honest broker trying to bring them together and reach a solution and so on. Now, that's real religious faith. I mean, the kind that you rarely get in organized religions, because the evidence is so vastly against it. It takes deep irrational commitment to power to even entertain that thought. I mean, if there were serious negotiations going on, they would be run by some neutral party that has some international respect, like maybe Brazil. And on one side would be Israel and the United States. On the other side, it'd be the rest of the world. I mean, asking the United States to mediate is kind of like asking Iran to mediate in Sunni-Shia conflicts in Iraq. Yeah, we'd laugh, you know. And we would laugh about this, too, if we weren't so deeply indoctrinated. For 35 years, the United States has been blocking the international consensus on a political settlement. How can it be a negotiator? How can it be a mediator? I mean, it's just this blind faith in power that's so deeply indoctrinated and embedded in the intellectual world that prevents us from seeing such obvious facts. The U.S. and Israel, The way you, what you read in the newspapers is that the Palestinians are insisting on preconditions for negotiation. Israel says, no, we don't want any preconditions. That's not true. The U.S. and Israel insist on crucial preconditions. One of them is that the U.S. must be the mediator, which already undercuts the legitimacy of any negotiations. The other precondition is that Israel must be permitted to continue its settlements. They're all illegal. There's no doubt about that. Every relevant international authority has determined that the International Court of Justice, the Security Council repeatedly, in fact, Israel itself admitted in as far back as 1967, yeah, of course they're illegal, all of them, but we're going to go ahead anyway. Israel and the U.S. insist that they be not only that their presence be a condition for negotiations, but that they must be permitted to expand. Now, theoretically, the U.S. claims to oppose that, but that's pure theory. When push comes to shove, the U.S. backs it. In fact, it did it pretty dramatically at the United Nations February 2011 when a Security Council resolution came along calling on Israel to stop expanding the settlements. That's official U.S. policy. It was vetoed by the Obama administration. They won't permit it, you know. So you really have to have, going back to faith, you have to have a lot of faith and not to see what's happening in front of your eyes. England is worse. Tony Blair has just made a total fool of himself on this. He's a laughing stock in most of the region. So you can't really begin to talk about these questions until you kind of extricate yourself from a lot of illusions. Look, I could be an algebraic topologist and do the same things they do in the world of human affairs. I mean, at some very abstract level, there's some kind of connection. Concern about the sources in our nature of the search for freedom and independence and creativity. It manifests itself in a crucial way in the nature of language, maybe our fundamental cognitive trait. And it manifests itself in social relations and ideas about how they should be constructed. But the connections are so tenuous that you can't draw conclusions from one to another. I mean, there could be people who do exactly the same work. In fact, there are. Pretty much the same work I do in linguistics. I have absolutely opposite political views and commitments. And there are people in other fields with, or no field, maybe just dedicated activists with whom I work who, yeah, who couldn't care less about linguistics. Yeah. Well, there are some principles or things going on around the world that are pretty general, but then there are things specific to particular regions and places. Like, take, say, Europe. Europe is kind of like lemmings walking off a cliff. The society is committing suicide, which is it's a little misleading. There's the designers of the policies understand what they're doing. And it may significantly harm the society, but it'll benefit interests that they serve. Mm-hmm. So the basic policies of austerity during recession or stagnation are suicidal for the society. You can read the studies by the International Monetary Fund reviewing dozens of cases, all of them collapse. And you can see the consequences just in the last couple of years. England, for example, it's, you know, every quarter is worse than the last one. Greece was, Spain, Portugal driven, Ireland driven to places, growth declines, debt increases, getting nowhere. I mean, the one example that's claimed to have been a success is Latvia, but that's extremely misleading when you look at it. And for one thing, it was a total economic disaster. There's some recovery from it, but largely because Latvians can leave their part. It's a small country, and they can go to get, you know, jobs in IT in Sweden or something like that. So I think about 10% of the population's left. That's no success. These policies are can't work in some respects. On the other hand, they can work for other purposes. They'll dismantle the social contract. They'll dismantle the welfare state. They'll weaken labor, strengthen concentrated private power. Well, from another point of view, that's a success. Mm-hmm. Actually, there's an interesting, it's not very much hidden. Mario Draghi, for example, at the ECB, recently had an interview with the Wall Street Journal in which he wasn't particularly praising it, but he simply said that the policies that the ECB, the Troika, you know, the big institutions are following is going to eliminate the social contract that Europe was based on. Well, from certain points of view, that's a success. Why should we accept workers' rights or the rights of the poor and so on? There's something comparable in the U.S. There's a very good economics institute in the United States called the Economic Policy Institute, which is the main source of regular data on the nature of the economy from the point of view of working people. It's the standard database. So they came out with a short monograph recently reviewing their own work of the last 30 years, pointing out what, you know, high concentration, extremely high concentration of wealth, stagnation or worse for most of the population, a decline in benefits, increase in working hours, people getting by on debt and bubbles and so on. They reviewed it. The title of the monograph is Failure by Design. What they point is, yes, it's the policies that have been followed are a failure for maybe, you know, 90% of the population. But it's a class-based failure. There's a sector of the population, not coincidentally the designers of the policy, for whom it's an enormous success. So it's and it's designed because there always have been alternative policies, and there still are. So it's failure by design. And I think something like that's pretty much true in Europe, except Europe may really do itself in severely if these policies continue. And you look at other parts of the world, and, you know, there's differences. I mean, but in general, the impact of, there have been over the past roughly 30 years, in most of the world, you know, some exceptions, but a lot of the world has been subjected to what are called general neoliberal policies. And almost invariably, it's been failure by design. It's harmed the general populations, benefited small sectors, led to increased corruption, harshness of life, breakdown of social order. Some do spectacularly well. In the city of London, they're not suffering, you know. Okay, or in Wall Street. In fact, they're richer than ever. You know, banks are bigger than ever. And the policies aren't great. You know, they're not, there's no economic laws that require them. It doesn't have to do with what's called globalization. You could have quite different policies at every stage of the game, but they would have different effects on, you know, on outcomes. On who gains and who loses. And those who design the policies are essentially achieving, they're achieving the kind of goal that I presume they want, you know, otherwise it wouldn't continue with the policies, and they're benefiting from it. And it's everywhere. I mean, take the Arab Spring. A lot of it, on the surface, a lot of it had to do with getting rid of dictators, which was true. But right underneath that was massive protest against neoliberal policies, which were highly praised by the international financial institutions. World Bank, IMF were praising Egypt and Tunisia for magnificent policies, great social economic progress. And by their standards, it was doing fine, except meanwhile for the population, things were getting worse and worse. Support systems were collapsing, wages were declining, There was growth, but very few pockets, enormous increase in corruption. Had to be an increase in violence, state violence, just to keep people under control. So it's one kind of success, another kind of failure. And that's something like that is true almost everywhere. There are exceptions. So for example, in the, say in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, one major exception was East Asia. Mm-hmm. That was the period of the rapid growth period in East Asia. But they rejected the rules, all of them. They rejected the whole Washington consensus, the neoliberal rules, and they did fine. China is pretty much the same. South America, which is maybe the most interesting case, was a very a religious adherent of the neoliberal principles in the 80s and the 90s, and the economies went into a tailspin. There was some, it looked for a while as if they were working, but it was an illusion and it crashed. The past decade, they've pulled out of the system and they're doing pretty well. For the first time, in fact, very well by historical standards. Now, there are kind of various weaknesses in the approaches they're taking, but it's been pretty much a success.
Okay.
So you have to look at what happens depends very much on the policies you pursue. I tend to be sympathetic towards the suggestions that are being made by groups as varied as Keynesian economists and the business press, literally, the business press, which is who are saying that for Europe to face its current problems, it has to have an increase in growth, and the increase in growth is not going to come from corporate investment under current situations because demand is too low. So there has to be an increase in demand. And the only way to do that is through government spending, which is perfectly possible. And that can stimulate the economies, which will grow, and over time that'll reduce. You can then later turn to the problems of deficit and debt to whatever extent they're problems. So the way, say, read Bloomberg Business Week, main business journal in the United States, what they say is that what's needed now is to push the accelerator. You can worry about pushing the brake later on after the accelerators develop the economy. You read the main, the most respected commentators in the Financial Times, like Martin Wolf, same thing pretty much. Mm-hmm. And there are others like Joseph Stiglitz, Paul Krugman, others are saying pretty much the same. And I think that's, in the short term, probably correct. There are other questions you can ask, deeper questions, like who ought to be making the decisions? Mm-hmm. So be concrete. Let's say when a couple of years ago, the Obama administration pretty much nationalized the American auto industry. Mm-hmm. They took them out, took it over, bailed it out, public basically owned it. Now, there were a couple of possibilities that could have been followed. One is the one that was followed, namely restructure the industry at taxpayer expense, hand it back to the former owners or people very much like them, maybe some new faces, but essentially the same, and have them continue to produce what they were producing, namely automobiles and trucks and so on. Another possibility would have been take the effectively nationalized industry, hand them over to the workforce and the communities to run and help them in producing things that the country really needs. Mm-hmm. Like if you've ever traveled in the United States, one of the things the country desperately needs is an efficient mass transit system. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's way behind almost the rest of the world and high-speed rail and infrastructure development. So, well, those are all things that can be done by the workforce that's sitting idly in so-called Rust Belt. Okay, that was an alternative policy. That would leave industry under popular control. Okay, that was not contemplated. But it's an alternative, and it's an alternative all over the place. And in fact, to some extent, it's being pursued in England too. There are cases, there's cooperatives, there's worker-run enterprises. That's an alternative economic model, which could be substantial changes, not like the narrow question of should you have government stimulus of growth when you need to increase demand. Mm-hmm. So there are questions that can be raised all across the board. Well, there's, I think, universal agreement that what's going on in Syria is a human catastrophe. And among those who know something about Syria, mm-hmm. there are people who know something, not many, but there are some, you know, Patrick Seale, Jonathan Steele in The Guardian, Charles Glass, correspondent. Among anyone who knows anything about Syria who I can find, there's the conclusion is that their conclusion about what should be done is essentially negative, mm-hmm. that any international intervention will make it worse, will make a bad situation worse. Mm-hmm. It'll drive an ongoing vicious civil war into an even more vicious one. It'll spread throughout the region. It'll sharpen Sunni-Shia conflicts, which are already very dangerous. So that looks like the worst of possible options. Well, are there better options? If there's a better option than essentially Kofi Annan's, I haven't heard it. Mm-hmm. It's not a good one. In fact, the mission just pulled out because it wasn't getting anywhere. And if you look at what they said, they're not getting anywhere because neither side is willing to abide by the conditions that they, the ceasefire conditions that they were trying to implement. Still, that's the hope for some kind of negotiated settlement that will permit the, I think it's pretty reasonable to assume that the Assad regime can't really remain. Mm-hmm. And the best idea would be to give it away to leave without them, without setting up a situation in which their choice is, shall we commit suicide or shall we just keep on murdering people? You don't want to leave them with that choice. You don't want to leave the Alawite community with the option of either being wiped out in a civil conflict or just going on carrying out murder. So you have to figure out negotiating options and diplomatic options that would permit those something within that range. Mm-hmm. It's not very nice. It means that people keep killing each other. But if there's a better idea, it's been kept a secret. Mm-hmm. I don't know of any. I mean, there are situations where it's just hard to think of a decent way out. Unfortunately, an expanding civil war mm-hmm. with the Syrian army going wild, various groups of rebels getting more and more military support from the outside, carrying out their own atrocities, and for the general population, increasing disaster. My feeling is that all outside forces should stop interfering. Mm-hmm. That means Russia, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, US, which is probably behind the organization of weapons flow. Mm-hmm. Turkey, they're all making the situation worse. Mm-hmm. They're pursuing their own interests. They're not the interests of the Syrian people. And they're the victims. Mm-hmm. It holds of the Russian ships. It holds of the arms going to the Free Syrian Army. So another point that should be made, the U.S. and Britain, basically, and France are saying that they're blocked from intervention because the U.N. Is paralyzed by the Russian-Chinese veto. Mm-hmm. That's a joke. If they want to do something, they won't care one way or another whether it's authorized by the Security Council. Just take a look at past practice. Mm-hmm. If they don't like what the Security Council is doing, they go ahead and do it anyway. So if we had internal documents now, my guess is what they would be saying is that in the White House and 10 Downing Street, they're probably pretty relieved at the Russian veto mm-hmm. because it gives a pretext not to do things which they don't want to do anyway. Mm-hmm. Well, you can. I mean, there are very good independent journalists. Mm-hmm. I actually mentioned a couple. Mm-hmm. Jonathan Steele with The Guardian, and Charles Glass is a freelancer. There's others who do serious, honest work on all sorts of issues. And there's enough, you know, there's enough freedom and openness so people can manage to survive. The main thrust of the media is going to be framed by, almost necessarily, by concentration of power, mm-hmm. and subordination to power. And that just gets built into people's consciousness. It's not necessarily that they're fearing repercussions. It's just you can't see the world differently than that. Mm-hmm. What you see the world, the way you see, it's like what I said about Israel-Palestine. You see the world a certain way. That's the way you're taught, that's the way you're trained, that's what you see in the communities around you. And to break out of those patterns of conformity and obedience is not easy. Mm-hmm. Some people do, but most people who try get punished in one way or another. So it tends to reinforce itself. So the media as institutions are going to tend to be conformist to power. You can see it all over the place. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'll pick almost any issue you like. Yeah. So take, say, the way dissidents are treated. Mm-hmm. In the United States, France, England, dissident means Eastern European dissident. Mm-hmm. And there's enormous attention given to the way they were treated in the Soviet Union. Mm-hmm. Václav Havel, Sakharov, others. Huge literature on it. Actually, I just was looking at a book on civil disobedience, nonviolent resistance to state oppression, mm-hmm. by two well-known British kind of left liberal commentators, mm-hmm. about 99% on Eastern Europe and a few things elsewhere. Okay, that's the point of view that Western power takes. Mm-hmm. The only dissidents who matter are those who resist pressure and violence of our official enemies. Mm-hmm. Actually, if you take a look at dissidents around the world, that's not the way it is. So, for example, say in Latin America, which is U.S. domains, mm-hmm. there's plenty of nonviolent resistance. And it doesn't get very far because it's usually just smashed by state violence backed by the U.S. Mm-hmm. So maybe in, say, Czechoslovakia, Václav Havel was imprisoned for a while, which is not nice. But his counterparts in El Salvador just had their brains blown out by security forces armed and trained by the United States. And if you look at the record, since in the post-Stalin era, say since roughly 1960, the record of atrocities, torture, murder, massacres in U.S. domains in Latin America far exceeds anything in Eastern Europe. But that's not the way we look at it. Mm-hmm. If you write a book on resistance to state oppression, you write about Eastern Europe, not about Latin America. If you write a book about courageous dissidents, you talk about the ones in Eastern Europe, not the ones in Latin America who faced much worse, much worse horrors. Actually, the victims understand this very well. So if you read the church press, mainstream intellectual commentary in Latin America, they're perfectly well aware of it. But Western intellectuals, it's not that they're suppressing it. You just can't see the world that way, because it would require looking at yourself. And that's very unpleasant. It's unpleasant to look into the mirror and say, this is what I'm doing. For one thing, it's unpleasant to think about it. And for another thing, if you do it, then you're morally obligated to do something about it, which can be hard and costly. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, if you lament the other fellow's crimes, that's makes you feel good. You're being humanistic. And you know, it's a good thing to do. You should be doing it. You win praise. You don't feel that you're under any moral compulsion to do anything more about it than lament and support them, which is fine but easy. And that's, and you pick any issue you like, you're going to find something like that. Mm-hmm. So it ends up with a highly conformist intellectual class, which reveals itself in the media, and in the media themselves, it's reinforced by other factors, like ownership, corporate pressure, advertising, government pressures, and so on, which kind of reinforce the natural tendency towards conformity and obedience in the intellectual classes. As far as I know, this goes back through history as far as you can trace it. It's very hard to find a society where this isn't true. And just try. If you go back to, go back to classical Greece, who drank the hemlock? Was it the person who was repeating the proper truisms, or the person who was accused of misleading the youth of Athens by worshiping false gods? Mm-hmm. Well, okay. Take a look at the biblical records at the same time. Mm-hmm. Now, there were people in the biblical records who are called prophets. If you take a look at the badly translated, obscure Hebrew word, then they weren't prophesying anything. They were what we would call intellectuals. They were criticizing the crimes of state, crimes of the king, giving geopolitical analysis, warning about the consequences of, antagonizing Syria and so on, calling for mercy to, orphans and widows and so on. That's what we would call dissident public intellectuals. How are they treated? Well, they were imprisoned, driven into the desert, denounced as haters of Israel, the origin of the word self-hating Jew, actually, the prophet Elijah. But centuries later, they were honored as prophets, centuries later. Mm-hmm. The people who were honored at the time are the ones who centuries later were condemned as false prophets in the Gospels and so on. Mm-hmm. And if that pattern runs right through history, it's extremely hard to find an exception. You see it on just issue after issue. So I take, say, the term intellectual in its modern sense, it came into use with the Dreyfusards in France. And we honor the Dreyfusards, but they weren't honored at the time. Emile Zola had to flee France. The French Academy, the immortals, were bitterly condemned the Dreyfusards as intellectuals who don't know what they're talking about, and they should leave issues to those who understand, and they're just a bunch of rabble-rousers and so on. Later, attitudes changed, but not then. If you go on a little bit to the First World War, which is a striking case, there were, in every country, England, the United States, Germany, every single one, intellectuals lined up enthusiastically in support of the war, overwhelmingly. There was a scattering of dissidents. It's like Bertrand Russell in England, or Rosa Luxemburg in Germany, or Eugene Debs in the United States. They ended up in jail. Mm-hmm. Maybe looking back 100 years, we can say it was a ridiculous, hideous war, and they were right, but not the way they were treated at the time. And see if you can find an exception to this in the historical record. It is so consistent that it's just like one of those truisms about history and about our own culture that we can't see. Mm-hmm. And that's real conformity, if you can't see something that's glaringly obvious and that governs your current behavior. So the way right now we treat, say, dissidents in Iran who are properly supported, we should be supporting them, and maybe we feel noble about supporting them, versus dissidents in our own domains who are treated maybe much worse, mm-hmm. who we even don't even know about, or refuse to look at.
A really quick question, which is, are you going to have haggis while you're in Scotland?
Am I
going
to?
Haggis?
No, I don't think so. I don't have time.
Oh, really? Okay.
I wish I didn't. Yeah. Actually, I'm leaving 5 o'clock tomorrow morning.
Oh, okay, good. Well, have a good flight.
Thank you for coming. I've had it before. Yeah.